Okay, welcome to the College of Complexes. My name's Don, and I'm going to be the moderator this evening. We have a very special program tonight. College regular, Corina Schusheim, is going to be talking on the topic, Was Malthus Correct? Corina is going to be talking about Thomas Malthus and his theory about overpopulation. Now let's introduce our speaker for the evening, Corina Schusheim.
Well, a conversation has been going on in the written media, and here we have an op-ed piece written by Peter Singer in the Washington Post. He's arguing for effective altruism, and he says, there is, however, a rational basis for ethics in the idea of transcending our particular local or tribal interests and taking a universal perspective. Absent the evidence that there is greater potential for happiness or misery in one person's life than in another, we should be equally concerned that every person and every sentient being is able to avoid suffering and find as much happiness and fulfillment as they can. From this basic principle, it follows that we should focus our charitable donations on people in extreme poverty in developing countries. That's because for any given sum, we can do more good by helping those in the greatest need. So some readers reacted to this. One reader wrote, Professor Singer is basically calling for donations that will achieve the greatest good for the greatest number for the fewest bucks. It would seem that what overwhelmingly meets this goal is a reduction of world population by use of contraception. Another reader wrote, I read some of Singer's books and I find his viewpoint to be admirable but a little simplistic. Using numbers of lives saved as a measure of charitable work just isn't enough. If you help a generation of children survive tropical diseases but then succumb to starvation when a drought strikes and now enlarge population, have you really accomplished anything? Yes, we probably should focus on poor countries rather than the U.S., but what we should be doing there is more complex than he makes it sound. To that, another reader responded, a focus on helping poor countries control their population growth might be the best thing the wealthy countries, which for the most part have exercised such control, can do to improve mankind's chances of survival. Here we have one of the columns by Nicholas Kristof. That was in the New York Times, entitled, Half the Kids in This Part of India Are Stunted. In a remarkable failure of democracy, India is the epicenter of global malnutrition. 39% of Indian children are stunted from poor nutrition, according to government figures. Other estimates are higher. Stunting is worse in India than Burkina Faso or Haiti, worse than in Bangladesh or North Korea. Here in Uttar Pradesh, a vast state of 200 million people in India's north, the malnutrition is even more horrifying. By the government's own reckoning, the slight majority of children under the age of 5 in this state are stunted, worse than any country in Africa save Burundi, according to the figures of the 2015 Global Nutrition Report. He goes on with the narrative, one woman we met, Celia Bano, is a villager with an 11-month-old girl named Mooney, who is acutely malnourished. The family does not have a toilet, few in the village do. Bano herself reflected other factors sometimes associated with malnutrition. She's illiterate, she was married at about 14. Mooney is her sixth child. Bano rejects birth control because she believes it's against God's wishes. Again, we have responses from readers. It has nothing to do with traditional eating habits of India. It has all to do with poverty and related effects. With great increase in population resulting from better nutrition and better availability of foods, newer problems of overcrowding and poverty have resulted in the last 70 years. India's population has increased from subcontinental value of 400 million to more than a billion in just post-partition India. So has the average lifespan of an Indian, from 28 years to more than 63 years now. Another reader who used the acronym Pilgrim wrote, whatever happened to charity begins at home. We can't possibly fix or save India or others from themselves. The will alone is not there. Too many people At this rate of unabated population explosion, it's only a matter of time until a few major diseases will recede the human tide. No amount of money can prevent this from happening. And Thomas from Singapore also had similar comments. This is about a country with the largest population in the world, in which human life is simply cheap, as for every person dying, there are at least 100 that will take his or her place. Overpopulation always produces disregard for individual lives, including children's lives. Now, these type of reader comments are very common in many different outlets whenever there's these stories about people in deep poverty. Often they will have 6 or 7 kids, and the readers in the developed countries will say, holy moly, that's a lot of kids. Why not just have less kids? Now let's look at the population theory of Thomas Malthus. He wrote the essay of the principle of population in 1798. This is during the Industrial Revolution, which was a major change. James Watt had created a separate chamber in the steam engine to collect steam, and that led to massive innovations. People were moving into cities from the farms. The textile industry became one of the largest employers, became the largest employer, and there were great lifestyle changes. And at this point, there were arguments that, hey, with more technology, we may end up with a super society, a more perfect society, a better man, or better mankind. And his book is a conclusive argument against the perfectibility of the mass of mankind. And the actual title is An Essay on the Principle of Population as it Affects the Future Improvement of Society, with remarks on the speculations of Mr. Goodwin, Monsieur Concordé, and other writers. And he has some basic postulates. Food is necessary for the existence of man. The passion between sexes is necessary and will remain nearly in its present state. Population, when unchecked, increases in a geometric ratio. Subsistence increases in an only arithmetic ratio. This implies a strong, constantly operating check on population from the difficulty of subsistence, misery, and vice. Now he gets more explicit in chapter 2. Okay, so we have this orange line and that green for you, human population, and then we have the lower line, which is the growth of subsistence. And so he really spells it out very pedantically in chapter 2. The population of this island, which is England, is computed to be about 7 million, and we will suppose a present produce equal to the support of such a number. In the first 25 years, the population would be 14 million, and the food also being doubled, the means of subsistence would be equal to this increase. In the next 25 years, the population would be 28 million, and the means of subsistence only equal to the support of 21 million. In the next period, the population would be just 56 million, and the means of subsistence sufficient for half that number. At the conclusion of the first century, the population would be 112 million, and the means of subsistence only equal to the support of 35 million, which would leave a population of 77 million totally unprovided for. He then spells this out again later in the chapter. Taking a population of the world at any number, 1,000 million, for instance, and this is interesting because around this time, the world human population is just about to reach the first 1 billion people. Taking population at any, for example, of 1,000 million, the human species would increase in the ratio of 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64. Those are all powers of 2. And subsistence as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. In the 2 centuries and a quarter, the population would be to the means of subsistence as 5, 12 to 10. In 3 centuries, 4,096 to 13. And in 2,000 years, the difference would be almost incalculable, though the produce in that time would have increased to an immense extent. Now, obviously, you can't have that. You can't have you can't have more people than more mouths to feed than there is food. So what happens? Well, we have checks on population growth, and a preventative check is something that stops people from having babies, which in Malthus's term is delayed marriage, because people don't have children out of clock, so you can delay marriage. So if we delay people from marrying, then we delay the baby making. And then we also have the positive checks, which is real miserable. This is want a proper, insufficient food, hard labor, just famine, war, pestilence, massive disease. And so all checks resolve into misery and vice. And he very strongly talks against the poor laws. He thinks that, perhaps not unfamiliar to some of the rhetoric today, destroys the incentive to be productive and to work hard, depending on poverty, ought to be held disgraceful, and it prevents savings in industry. What he actually did write in Chapter 5, the poor laws of England tend to depress the general condition of the poor in these two ways. The first obvious tendency is to increase population without increasing the food for its support. A poor man may marry with little or no prospect of being able to support a family in independence. This may be said, therefore, in some measure, to create the poor which they maintain. And, as the provisions of the country must, in consequence of the ever-increased population, be distributed to every man in smaller proportions. Secondly, the quantity of provisions consumed in workhouses upon part of society that cannot in general be considered as the most valuable part diminishes the shares that would otherwise belong to the more industrious and more worthy members, and thus, in the same manner, forces more to become dependent. If the poor in workhouses were to live better than they do now, this new distribution of the money of society would tend more conspicuously to depress the condition of those out of the workhouses by occasioning a rise in the price of provisions. So you're adding more people and you're making subsistence more expensive. Remember what I'm saying here. He wraps it up in Chapter 7 before going on refuting this idea of perfectibility of mankind. What he says here is, must it not then be acknowledged by an attentive examiner of the histories of mankind that in every age, in every state in which man has existed or does now exist, that the increase of population is necessarily limited by the means of subsistence? The population does invariably increase when the means of subsistence increase, and that the superior power of population is repressed, and the actual population kept equal by the means of subsistence by misery and vice. So there's a whole other part of the book where he talks about why we can't make a more perfect society. Not knowing what a limit is not the same as not having a limit or being limitless. This book is an influential book, and it shows up in both fiction and nonfiction. And so for my next section, I would like to quickly go through that, examples of where it has shown up. Here we have Charles Darwin, 1838. In October 1838, that is 15 months after I had begun my systematic inquiry, I happened to read for amusement, and I don't know what connotation amusement has, if that's sarcastic, but I happened to read for amusement, Malthus on Population. Being well prepared to appreciate the struggle for existence, which everywhere goes on from long-continued observations of the habits of animals and plants, it at once struck me under these circumstances, favorable variations would tend to be preserved, unfavorable ones destroyed, and the result would be the formation of a new species. Here we have Charles Darwin, A Christmas Carol, 1843, a very well-known, beloved book. And this bit that I've copied here sets the scene, the character of Scrooge, where a man comes asking for philanthropic donations, and Scrooge says, you know, "Are there no prisons?" asks Scrooge. "Plenty of prisons," says this gentleman, laying the pen down again. "And in union workhouses. Are they still in operation?" "They are still. I wish I could say they were not." "The treadmill and the poor laws are in full vigor, then." "Both very busy, sir." They go back and forth. "I hope to support these establishments I've mentioned. They cost enough, and those who are badly off must go there. Many can't go there. Many would rather die." "If they would rather die, they had better do it and decrease the surplus population." Now we have a book by Thomas Hardy, Tess of the D'Urbervilles. This is standard in high school, and Tess is a young maiden, and Daddy is a drunk, and Mommy is a simpleton, and they hang out all day at the bar. They live in the countryside. As Tess grew older and began to see how matters stood, she felt quite Malthusian towards her mother for thoughtlessly giving her so many little sisters and brothers when it was such a trouble to nurse and provide for them. Her mother's intelligence was that of a happy child. Joan Derbyfield was simply an additional one, and that one not the eldest to her own long family of waiters on Providence. This is actually more vicious here. This is The Good Earth, written by Pearl S. Buck in 1931. And in this chapter, Wang Lung, who is a farmer, he goes through some really rough times. He has to move into the city and operate a rickshaw, which is not glamorous. And I listened to this book when I was driving back and forth to a job and audio tape, and this really stuck out to me. At home in small hovels where they lived, around Wang Lung's hovel, heaped one on top upon another, the women sewed rags together to make coverings for the children. They were forever breeding, and they snatched at bits of cabbage from the farmer's field and sold handfuls of rice from the grain markets, and gleaned the year-round the grass on the hillside. And at harvest, they followed the reapers like fowls, their eyes piercing and sharp for every drop, grain, or stalk. And through these huts passed children. They were born and dead and born again until neither mother or father knew how many had been born or died, scarcely even knew how many were living, thinking of them only as mouths to be fed. And we're going to continue. Here we have a book. This is Arthur Herman, and he wrote about the Bengali famine. His book is Gandhi versus Churchill, Gandhi and Churchill, the epic rivalry that destroyed an empire and forged our age. He wrote that Secretary of State for India, Leo Amery, Herman writes, at first took a lofty Malthusian view of the crisis, arguing that India was overpopulated and the best strategy was to do nothing. But by early summer, even Amory was concerned and urged the war cabinet to take drastic action. Later he wrote, for his part, Churchill proved callously indifferent since Gandhi's fast, his mood about India had progressively darkened. He was resolutely opposed to any food shipments. Ships were desperately needed for the landings in Italy. Remember, this is during World War II. Besides, Churchill felt it would do no good. Famine or no famine, Indians will breed like rabbits. Amory prevailed on him to send some relief, albeit only a quarter of what was needed. And here we have Paul Ehrlich. Paul Ehrlich was encouraged to write this book by the Sierra Club. He actually did co-write it with his wife Anne, although they only put his name on it because he was a doctorate. And this is his book, The Population Bomb. And he talks about policies you could do to encourage people to have less kids. He's not concerned specifically about lack of subsistence. He's concerned more about environmental degradation. And that you're going to ruin the environment, the water, the soil. Not that you can't produce enough grain. He really sets the tone very early on in chapter one. I've understood the population explosion intellectually for a long time. I came to understand it emotionally one stinking hot night in Delhi a couple of years ago. My wife and daughter and I were returning to our hotel in an ancient taxi. The seats were hopping with fleas. The only functional gear was third. As we crawled through the city, we entered a crowded slum area. The temperature was well over 100, and the air was a haze of dust and smoke. The streets seemed alive with people, people eating, people washing, people sleeping, people visiting, arguing, screaming, people thrusting their hands through the taxi window begging, people defecating and urinating, people clinging to buses, people hurting animals, people. As we moved slowly through the mob, hand horns squawking, the dust, noise, heat, and cooking fires gave the scene a hellish aspect. Will we ever get to our hotel? All three of us were, frankly, frightened. It seemed that anything could happen, but of course nothing did. Old India hands will laugh at our reaction. We were just some overprivileged tourists unaccompanied to the sights and sounds of India, perhaps. But since that night, I've known the feel of overpopulation. But he The book is very plainly written, and he feels that instead of having a tax deduction for children, you should actually be taxed more for children. There should be a tax on diapers, on cribs, and luxury goods. Instead of like an EPA for the environment, it should be the population and the environment. He was very much in favor of abortion, and actually not so much in favor of contraception because he didn't feel like it really was an effective way of limiting the population. Now this is one of the more shocking things. This was also written in 1948, and this is Representative George H.W. Bush. And prior to him joining and becoming the running mate with Ronald Reagan at the time of the moral majority, he had a nickname. It was Rubbers. Mr. Speaker, sitting as I have in the Tax Ways and Means Committee, which has a responsibility for Social Security legislation, I've heard almost endless testimony to the effect of our national welfare costs are rising phenomenally, prompting me to wonder how we could take basic steps to arrest it. But the problem is by no means wholly financial. It's emphatically human, a tragedy of unwanted children and of parents whose productivity is impaired by children they never desired. He then calls at the end, and this almost now makes me think of right now El Salvador, who's going through a massive crisis. The federal government, along with many state governments, has taken steps to accelerate family planning activities in the United States, but we need to do more. We have a clear precedent. When the soft vaccine was discovered, large-scale programs were undertaken to distribute it. I see no reason why similar programs of education and family planning assistance, all voluntary basis, should not be instituted in the United States on a massive scope. It is imperative that we do so, not only to fight poverty at its roots, not only to cut down on our welfare costs, but to eliminate the needless suffering of unwanted children and overburdened parents. Now, this is a very important man. This is Norman Borlaug, who was a biologist, and he worked in Mexico and India. Penn and Teller, in an episode of Bullshit, feted him as one of the most important men who have ever lived, because he did save billions of lives. And what he did is he really went out into the field, into the arid environments, and he planted crops and crossbred crops and planted crops and figured which crops were going to survive. And in 1970, he won the Nobel Prize, and it actually is, he gives this acceptance speech that's very Malthusian. For we're dealing with two opposing forces, the scientific power of food production and the biologic power of human reproduction. Man has made amazing progress recently in his potential mastery of these two contending powers. Science, innovation, and technology have given him materials and methods for increasing his food supply substantially, and sometimes spectacularly. As I hope to prove tomorrow, my first address as a newly decorated and dedicated Nobel laureate, man has acquired the means to reduce the rate of human reproductive effectively and humanely. He is not using his, he is not yet adequately using adequately his potential for decreasing the rate of human reproduction. The result is the rate of population increase exceeds the rate of increase in food production in some areas. There can be no permanent progress in the battle against hunger until agencies that fight for increased food production and those that fight for population control unite in a common effort. Fighting alone, they may win temporary skirmishes, but united they can win a decisive victory and lasting victory to provide food and other amenities of a progressive civilization for the benefit of all mankind. So he didn't think that you should just increase crop yield. He also wanted and was frustrated that the human there was lack of progress in reducing human population. Now, this is one of the many dystopic movies that was...
Well, that's great. Well, yeah.
Yeah, and so let's see if our video works here. And... just a second. Oh, wait, you're not playing this now. Oh, wait, this isn't playing, Tim?
It is now.
Greeting people.
You're not, wait, they can't see this. They're not able to see this?
Click on the thing. Click on the picture.
Yeah.
Try it again.
Well, I'm playing it, but they're not seeing it. I'm going to try again. What I'm going to do is just play it, actually, because I have the video downloaded. You guys are having too much fun over there. Just a second.
That's only 5 years away.
Soylent Green.
Yeah.
It's coming pretty close, isn't it?
Beware, beware.
No, but this is part of the talk, so.
Technology.
Just a second.
Something. Volume only. Come on, volume only. What the heck?
She's got it up on the wrong screen.
Oh, it's got it on
there.
Super salad.
Oh, salad.
No wrong. No,
you know it.
Helps come. She's coming. Somebody's coming.
What?
Yes.
What's going on?
Tech control.
It's a musical comedy.
Wants the money on
it.
Money on
it. I thought somebody gave me something.
We'll figure it out. Let's skip it.
I don't want to spend too much time.
What's that? What's that?
Okay.
That's much better.
What's that? I've
never seen that. Okay, that's it.
I would never see it.
Is it a contraceptive device?
Huh?
I mean, maybe.
Shh.
How
are
you doing?
Okay, fuck it.
That's what the Lord said is okay.
The time is changing.
You made a boy and a girl.
Go back to your PowerPoint slide.
Yeah, I can't find the mouse.
It's showing up on this screen.
Once in a while,
it's on the second radio.
It's turned on. Based on the one you can't see the cursor.
Oh, wait a second.
It's over there.
It's on that screen. I can see it.
Okay,
there, it's right there.
Let me go to the home and do
the gesture.
Okay,
here.
Thank you.
No, I think you got it.
You're saying you were born. You're all the
orders.
No.
Go back to your PowerPoint.
I can't. It won't show on the screen.
No, I need this. Bring me plastic bag. Bring me plastic bag, okay? No, thank you.
Because if I go to this PowerPoint now,
How you been doing?
Good. How about you?
Okay.
Yeah. Ain't seen in a while, man.
Everybody, give Tim a shout out.
Yay! Timmy. Slow down.
All right. So this is Richard Dawkins, and Richard Dawkins has some very harsh words. He says, "What has happened in modern civilization In civilized man is that family sizes are no longer limited by finite resources that individual parents can provide. If a husband and wife have more children than they can feed the state, which means the rest of the population simply steps in and keeps the surplus children alive and healthy. There is, in fact, nothing to stop a couple with no material resources at all from having and rearing precisely as many children as a woman can physically bear. But the welfare state is a very unnatural thing. In nature, parents who have more children than they can support do not have many grandchildren, and their genes are not passed on to future generations. There's no need for altruistic restraint in the birth frame, because there is no welfare state in nature. Any gene for overindulgence is promptly punished. The children containing the gene starve. Since we humans do not want to return to the old selfish ways, I really wish you were sitting down and not just standing up. He goes on to say,
Are you okay?
I don't know. I know who I am, but I don't know where I am. Where am I going?
You want some coffee?
You're in heaven, man. You're in
Since we humans don't want to return the old selfish way, where we let children of two large families self to get starved to death, we have abolished the family as a unit of economic self-sufficiency and substituted the state. But the privilege of guaranteed support for children should not be abused. And another party says contraception is sometimes a tax as unnatural, so it is very unnatural. Trouble is, so is the welfare state. I think that most of us believe the welfare state is highly desirable, but you can't have unnatural welfare unless you also have unnatural birth control. Otherwise, the end result will be misery greater than that which obtains in nature. The welfare state is perhaps the greatest altruistic system the animal kingdom has ever known. Any altruistic system is inherently unstable because it's open to abuse by selfish individuals ready to exploit it. Individual humans who have more children than they are capable of rearing are probably too ignorant, or in most cases, to be accused of conscious malevolent exploitation. Powerful institutions and leaders who deliberately encourage them to seem to be less free from suspicion. Here we have. That's going to come up in one or two rebuttals, but here now we have really the reason why I gave this talk. This is Live Aid, and I remember this. There was a huge famine, and it was going on in Ethiopia, but as you can see, they used in their logo the entire state of Africa, the entire continent of Africa, not Ethiopia. And this is this was very dramatic. It was on the news. You saw the stick figures, the kids with the sunken eyes and the bloated bellies and these very reedy arms and legs and the lyrics. The first thing was Band-Aid. It was a super band composed of popular bands. They said, do they know it's Christmas? There's a world outside your window, and it's a world of dread and fear where the only water flowing is a bitter sting of tears, and the Christmas bells that ring there are the clanging chimes of doom. Well, thank God tonight it's them instead of you. And there won't be snow in Africa this Christmas time. The greatest gift they'll get this year is life. Oh, nothing ever grows, no rain or river flows. Do they know it's Christmas at all? And now we have a popular video, Roy Beck. He made this video in 1999, and he's made a follow-up to this video. This is Numbers USA. It's an organization that started out by people who were originally environmentalists but have now become an anti-immigration group, and he uses gum holes to demonstrate overpopulation. The fact is that last year we took in about 1 million people, but last year a third of the world added births over deaths, another 80 million people into this impoverished persons of the world. And this year we take 1 million people, and this year the third world will add another 80 million people more. Imagine gumballs pouring all over the place. And next year the U.S. government insists on bringing the exorbitant non-traditional levels of immigration and brings another 1 million people. These people will still add another 80 million in the world into the impoverished numbers in the world. There's no way that we can ever get ahead of it. We cannot be a safety valve. We can take millions a year, totally destroy the social fabric of this country, totally destroy the environmental resources, ruin any possibility of lower skilled people in this country having any kind of decent standard of living, we still would not get ahead of this. If you want to help the third world, just a second. Okay, if we want to help the third world, immigration is meaningless. The most important thing we can do is answer the requests third world nations that have been begging us for years to help them with family planning assistance. Okay. Here we have Hans Rosling. He has videos. He's often a speaker at the TEDx conferences and has videos such as, he's a physician, he worked in Africa. Will saving poor children lead to overpopulation? And this last one is Pope Francis. And this was a shock when I first heard this. He was in an in-flight press conference on his way back to Rome from his journey to the Philippines, telling the story of a woman he met in a parish in Rome several months ago, who had given birth to 7 children via cesarean section and was pregnant with an 8th. Francis asked, "Does she want to leave 7 orphans? This is a tempt God," he said, adding later, "This is an irresponsibility. Catholics," the Pope said, "should speak of responsible parenthood." How we could do this? Francis asked, with dialogue. Each person with this pastor seeks how to do that responsible parenthood. God gives you methods to be responsible, he continued. Some think that, excuse the word, in order to be good Catholics, we have to be like rabbits. No, this is clear. And this is why the church, there are marriage groups, and there are experts in this matter, and there are pastors, Francis said, using the term for a practice that follows church law, he continued. I know so many illicit ways that have helped this. Now, Paul Ehrlich is not one to endorse the rhythm method. In fact, in his book, he says that people who use the rhythm method go by the word parents.
Yeah.
This is nice to acknowledge this, but hey, Francis, do you want to talk about the illicit ways? Does that include orthotricycline or condoms or tubal ligation? Now let's actually look at the demographic situation here. You can see that world population has largely been a hockey stick configuration. Professors will say that Malthus has actually very much accurately described population growth up until his time, but he doesn't describe the future after the Industrial Revolution, when you clearly see that population grows more than exponentially. This is a real hockey stick configuration. So Malthus is writing almost around 1800, and it's right before you see this massive explosion. The Industrial Revolution had many new technologies, including technologies to be used on a farm, things like thrashers and other. Also, in the 1800s, you see the Europeans take over the rest of the of this continent, and that includes territories like Indiana, Illinois, Iowa, the breadbasket where we grow all our grains, and so we're able to produce food a lot more. But you see, the population has grown massively. Currently, the world population is around 7.3 billion. The United States, this is according to the world census, is around 323 million. So on average, there's a birth every 8 seconds, a death every 10 seconds. International net migrant immigration over emigration every 29 seconds. So we gain a person every 17 seconds. Our population in the United States is growing. Here we are now, and you're seeing this explosive growth that may hit 9.5 or 10 billion by the year 2050. The world population increased from 3 billion, and this is from the census again, 3 billion in 1959 to 6 billion in 1999, a doubling that occurred over 40 years. The Census Bureau, it will continue into the 21st century and then taper or hopefully slow down. What you have is population in billions per year, Here we have the growth rate, and there seems to be a dip around 1960. The dip in the growth rate from 1959 to 60 was due to the Great Leap Forward in China. During that time, both natural disasters and decreased agricultural output in the wake of massive social reorganization caused China's death rate to rise sharply and its fertility rate to fall by almost half. Yay, Chairman Mao. But the world population growth rate rose, it seemed to have peaked around between the 1960s and the 1970s, and then as a result, you're looking at growth rate percentage over time, but the actual population increase really maxes out. This is the annual change, the additional people added to the world every year, and that seems to max out around the 80s and the 90s. In addition to growth rates, another way to look at population growth is to consider annual changes in total population. The annual increase in world population increased around 87 million in the late 80s. The peak occurred then, and now we're adding less and less people per year, but our population is still growing. Until this red line drops below zero, we're still having a net increase. So it's positive philosophy, but negative acceleration. It's deceleration. So. Yeah. We're adding more people, but we're adding less of them, but it's still a net gain of people. Now, people are having less babies, okay? So the global birth rate, in 1970, the average woman had nearly six children. In 2013, the average woman had below three. I'm going to explain that. More than half of the world's citizens now reproduce at below replacement rate. There's women like me who don't have any children. Thankfully. In many countries, including the United States and India, the birth rate only just exceeds replacement rate. And what you're gonna see when I show you the population pyramids is that it really remains high in mostly the developing world. You'll see that, yeah. But when you're looking at religions, this is the countries with the largest drops in fertility rates between 1960 to 2012. And we can talk about religions. You see that Iran, United Arab Emirate, those are Islamic majority countries. Then you have Dominican Republic, Nicaragua, Honduras, which are relatively Catholic countries. Korea is Eastern. Again, Bahrain, Qatar, they've had massive drops in world population in fertility rates, and that's one of the I can run an application. I don't know if you can see it by Gapminder, and it shows a bubble graph. But the Chinese, the Eastern Asian religions, Christian countries, and Islamic countries, they've all dropped in fertility. Again, that's Hans Rosling and Gapminder. Maybe I could show it when I shut down PowerPoint. 60% of the world population really is in Asia. And this number for Europe also includes Russia. So this is the total population with both sexes. And you see that Africa has 1 billion people, but wait, India has over 1.25 billion people, so do China. And so Africa is one of the lesser populated. This massive continent of Africa is one of the lesser populated areas. So Africa, this massive continent, has 30.2 billion million square miles. And that's more land mass than China, EU, United States, China, European Union, India, and Japan, which only has 27.5 million square miles. So if you're just looking at straight numbers causing poverty, you can see that Africa actually has less people. The balance of the people in the world really are in Asia. That doesn't, in terms of growth rate, it's a different story. And there's problems. We have 1 billion people chronically hungry. They wake up hungry, hungry all day. 1 billion people live in slums, not the same billion, but there's some overlap. Nearly 1 billion are illiterate. Two-thirds of the people who are illiterate are women. And about 200 to 215 million women don't have access to contraceptions, which they should have, okay? And half of all pregnancies are unintended, which is a shame, okay? But it's not all gloom and doom. And so you see the fact the world's population living in extreme poverty hasn't doubled or remained the same. It's fallen by more than half, from 35% in 1993 to 14% in 2011. And he the number of extremely poor people, that's people living on $1.25 a day, $1.25 a day, rose inexorably until the middle of the 20th century, stabilized, and then has plummeted since the 90s. In 1990, more than 12 million people died before the age of 5. This total has dropped by more than half. And more kids than other are becoming educated, especially girls. In the 1980s, only a half of girls in developing countries completed elementary school. Now 80% do. So we've made some tremendous strides, some tremendous gains. Now let's look. This, I'm going to show you the very important demographic transition model.
Sorry, I was supposed to microphone sound.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I don't know if you
have
to
talk away
further,
from
it.
About a fist away, you're all set. Right?
Yeah, just one pool at a
okay.
time, y'all.
I got it. Okay, so here we have a crude birth rate, number of births divided by population times 1,000, crude death rate, number of deaths divided by country's population times 1,000.
Corina.
The natural growth.
Wait, Corina, listen, why don't you need to stand further away from it.
Okay. Natural growth represents births, and natural growth is the birth rate minus the death rate. That's the natural growth rate, and the overall growth is natural growth plus immigration. And in the developing world, the replacement level is roughly 2.1 births per woman, which many countries in Europe fall far below that, and you'll see that. So the doubling time, how long does it take for a population to double? Well, take the natural logarithm of 2. So if the United States had an average growth rate of 2% a year, it would take us 35 years to double and 55 years to triple.
We're not in that category. We're lower than that.
So here you have a very important demographic transition model. The demographic transition model seeks to explain transformation of countries from having high birth rate and death rates to low birth rates and death rates. In developed countries, this transition began in the 18th century and continues today. Less developed countries, though I would argue it's more like the Industrial Revolution that really divided it, less developed countries began the transition later and still in the midst of the changes. But you're looking here, and this line is the crude death rate, and this top line is the crude birth rate. So in the beginning, life is nasty, short, and brutish. Lots of people are living, lots of people are dying. Population is pretty much stable. And it's funny to look at life expectancy, because maybe you're born and you have a low life expectancy, but if you can make it to the age of 15, you may have a life expectancy of 30 or 35 years. But this is life is nasty, short, and brutish, as Hobbes said. And you have some dips in the population because of things like the bubonic plague, but population is relatively stable. And that's what you're looking at for the majority of time. You're seeing here that the population is relatively stable. And then all of a sudden the death rates start to plummet. You have major innovations in both sanitation more than medicine. Sanitation has really, really made the difference. For a long time, doctors really did nothing for you or did very little for you, and medicine wasn't based on science, really. Germ theory came, wasn't it 1930 that antibiotics...
Late 19th century.
Well, but the antibiotics came in 1930s, I believe. I mean, just... So the birth rate remains high, but the death rate goes down, and this gap between the two lines is where you have massive population growth. Mm-hmm. And here you are here, and this is evidence of that. And then finally, you're into the final stages where people then say, hey, having kids is expensive. It costs money. Since my kids don't work on a farm and since my kids need education, it costs a lot, so I'm going to have less of them. And you have things to do at night. You have artificial light at night, and there's other things, new ways to entertain yourself, using television, radio, computer, or whatever, playing solitaire. But the lights don't go out as early, and so you still have a low death rate. And if you do have population growth, it's mostly caused by immigration. Yeah. And you've seen this. We've seen this lowering. So here we are in Western Europe, and it seems that there's this 1960, 1965 you start to see, and then it just kind of mellows out here. But around here you see this massive turn, and people stop having kids. After the baby boom, I would say 1945, World War II ended, and then we have a baby boom, but then comes this, and this is also around the time, 1964, 1965, we have the birth control pill, and women, I am woman, hear me roar, and I don't want these red rats around, okay? And this is Eastern Europe, which is seems to have, you know, one in the 1960s, 65, but then it seems to me around the time the end of communism, 1989, seems to be another turn where population growth goes down. And here you are in East Asia, and this is South America, and so the population growths are this. We're not shrinking our, unless this actually goes below zero, we're not shrinking our population, but what is happening is the natural increase has greatly decreased here. So this is from the group Population Connection, which used to be zero population growth in stage one, which applies to most of the world. Nobody's in it now. Before the Industrial Revolution, birth rates and death rates are high. Stage two, introduction of modern medicine and sanitation, I think is bigger, lowers the death rate, especially among children. Much of Sub-Saharan Africa, Guatemala, Nauru, Palestine, Yemen. And then here you are in stage three, and this gap between the birth and the death rate is starting to shrink. Birth rates gradually decrease, usually as a result of improved economic conditions, increase to women's status, access to contraception. Botswana, Colombia, India, Jamaica, Kenya, Mexico, South Africa, United Arab Emirates. And then you have stage four. Birth and death rates are both low, stabilizing the population, stronger economies, higher level of education, better health care, higher proportion of working women, and a fertility rate hovering around two per children per woman. So it's Argentina, Australia, Canada, Brazil, most of Europe, Singapore, South Korea, and the U.S. But then we also have a stage five. That includes countries in which the fertility rate has fallen significantly below replacement levels. And the elderly population is greater than the young. Croatia, Estonia, Germany, Greece, Japan, Portugal, and Ukraine. So I'm going to start showing you statistics. Assuming I have time, this is United Nations, the World Bank, and CIA World Factbook. Now, a population pyramid illustrates the age and sex structure of a country's population. The population is distributed along the horizontal axis, with males shown on the left and females on the right. The male and female populations are broken down into groups. So this is 0 to 4 years old, 5 to 9, 10 to 14, 15 to 19, 20 to 24, all the way up. The higher you go, the older they get. So the youngest age groups are at the bottom. And this is the world population now. And here we have the population from different continents. And I plan to zoom through because I showed ones of different countries here. And here you have North America. Here you have Central America, and you can see that Honduras and Costa Rica and Nicaragua and El Salvador were kind of shrinking. Panama still seems to be growing, as is Belize. Here you have South America. And then you see Western Europe, which is really shrinking. You see that Western Europe has an older population, and I'm going to show you that later when I show you median age of population. I noticed that France was an outlier here, and what actually happens is that France actually started using contraception before the rest of Europe, and then they had a demographic recuperation of demographics, so now they're actually more likely to, their fertility rate is more like 2.1. Here you have the Scandinavian countries, Eastern Europe. This is very drastic, especially in... now, watch what happens when we go into Africa here. See what a young... See, yeah. Now these... The lighter shades are the populations that are below 15. These first three bars, they're 15 years of age or younger. And here's Central Africa. And here's East Africa. See, it's a pyramid shape. It's much wider at the bottom than it is at top. And this contrasts greatly with Europe, with both Eastern and Western, Western and Eastern Europe. And here you have the Middle East. This is interesting because the Saudi Arabia and Oman have a large male population. I'm going to try to end at 7:30.
Okay.
Here we have the Russian Federation, and here we have Central Asia, and here's Southeast Asia. South Asia, I'm sorry. But very important, both Bangladesh and India are starting to taper off. India is extremely, they're both large populations, but you're seeing that they're having less children, as is Nepal and Bhutan. Afghanistan still seems to be very highly fertile, and you'll see that later on. Here you have East Asia. Again, Japan has a very much an older population as the Hong Kong, see, so, and but South Korea is one of the tigers. In South Korea and Hong Kong, they have a far smaller young population. This is Oceania. Now, these are the 10 most populous countries, and the United States is third, but it's only a fraction of the size of India. And China and India, India may supersede China, which has stabilized its population. Even if the Chinese government got rid of the one-child policy, each individual family in China has their own economic situation to consider and balancing job and education. But the United States is a very distant third from China and India, so both these countries have over 1.25 billion people, okay? And the least populated are largely island nations. That also includes the Holy See and Tikilo. I don't know what that is, but... Now, this is a distorted map where the countries are misshapen per their population size, and you see how large China and India are, and you have the United States and Brazil and Nigeria and Bangladesh and Pakistan. In terms of population density, Monaco is one of the most densely populated countries. Where is Monaco? Monaco?
Monaco is
in
the south of France.
Yes, Monaco is it's the Riviera, like you have France, you have Italy, but it's this beautiful, if you've seen To Catch a Thief by Alfred Hitchcock, absolutely a gorgeous area, but I think...
Northern Mediterranean.
Yeah, it's a very wealthy, but it's very densely populated. And you see the population density... is not really deterministic of lifestyle, because here you have... Now Europe, Asia is the most population dense continent, 141. This is population, how many people per square kilometer. Asia's more dense than Africa. But Africa's more dense than Europe, but that also includes Russia, okay? So Africa is more dense than Europe plus including Russia, but Western Europe is 60 people per square kilometer, whereas Africa is only 40 people per square kilometer. In North America is only 19 people per square kilometer, but we're looking at the density statistics in Haiti, Israel, Japan, El Salvador. I just pulled some of these out.
Yeah.
The United States population density is between El Salvador and Pakistan, so you have El Salvador, United Kingdom, Pakistan, Germany, Nigeria, and Nepal. So population density doesn't necessarily determine the wealth or the lifestyle of a country. Here, the least populated countries are hard to live in. Western Sahara, Australia is largely arid, Iceland, not a lot of people. Greenland doesn't have a large population density.
Here we are by world population density. You see the China, Japan, you see California, you see our East Coast and Great Lakes region, and here you have Europe, Italy and Germany and the UK. And by rates of natural increase, again, as I showed you in the population pyramids, Niger, Gambia, Uganda, Mali, Burundi, Senegal, Angola. These are fertility rates. Total fertility rate represents the number of children that would be born to a woman if she were to live to the end of her childbearing years or bear children in accordance with the current age-specific fertility rates. Niger, Mali, Somalia, Chad, Burundi, Nigeria. So while Africa's not densely populated, it is where tomorrow's adults are going to be. Yeah. Oh, they are multiplying. Yes, you see that. So, you know, you say, Corina, why don't you have seven children? I say, no way. No, that's not going to happen. And these, I just tried to use different sources just to compare, just to make sure that, so these are the CIA sources. Again, Niger, Burundi, Mali, Somalia, Uganda, Burkina Faso, Malawi, Angola, Afghanistan, and South Sudan. The new state of South Sudan. Is it 10 years old or? I don't
know.
Yeah. And these who have been gaining in fertility rate, West Bank and Gaza, Kosovo, well, Greenland, but Niger, Gambia.
Did we miss any?
This is some that have decreased.
Oh, yeah, by a lot.
And I'm wondering what's going on here. This Bulgaria, these have had a natural decrease. Now, why have they had this natural decrease? What's going on? So this is a crude birth rate minus a crude death rate. When you see the death rate is higher than the birth rate, what's going on? Well, if you're looking here, well, there's high death, though. Bulgaria has a third highest death rate. Ukraine has a second highest death rate. Latvia, fifth. Lithuania, seventh. And they seem to have high death rates. There are some areas with a high, after communism, have high rates of alcoholism.
Whoa.
And
Russia, oh, yeah.
I'm noticed because I needed to look in and figure out why has Eastern Europe, you know, shrunk so much. Yeah, and so some of these other countries down here, Japan, 9.51 deaths, but it's an aging population. It's not that different, but you're really seeing a big difference. Bulgaria, Serbia, Latvia, Lithuania, Ukraine, Hungary. These are countries where the death rate outdoes, and they have high death rates. Fertility rates, who's shrinking? Here we have our tigers, Singapore, Hong Kong, Korea, and Macau, which is part of China. But then again, Spain has a very low population, the fertility rate. These are all well below 2 children per woman. This is a shrinking fertility rate. Here you are again, just to compare the CIA, 2013, Singapore, Macau, Taiwan, Hong Kong, South Korea. Malaysia doesn't seem to fit in here, but and the countries that have dropped in fertility rates, again, you have some Islamic countries, Iran, United Arab Emirates, but then you have the Dominican Republic, Nicaragua, Honduras, Qatar. And population growth, Oman has grown, so has Lebanon, Kuwait, South Korea. Top 10 countries by population growth, Niger seems to be growing, Malawi, Sudan, and I think it's just natural population growth. Bottom 10 by population growth.
Okay. About 5 minutes, Corina.
Okay, so let's look at the median ages here, and Niger is a very young country with a median age. Okay, age that divides a population in 2 parts of equal size. That is, there's many people with ages above the median as there are with ages below the median. And here you have the oldest countries are Japan, Germany, Martinique, Italy, Portugal, Greece, Bulgaria. These all have people above 40. Around my age, basically, the median age person is me. I'm 43 years old, and here you're seeing countries that are have an aging population. So over half their population is over the age of 40. They're geezers like we are. And this is just age dependency. I think I'm going to rip through this. But infant mortality rate also is in these countries that have these high growth rates. Niger, Angola, Burkina Faso, Nigeria, Chad, Mali. I was worried about in Afghanistan. These have high infant mortality rates, and they also have high growth rates. And then Japan, which has a shrinking population, Singapore, another one, Hong Kong, have very low infant mortality rates. Monaco, as I said, a wealthy country with a high population density. And life expectancy at birth, very high, Monaco, Japan, Singapore, Macau, and places where you can, below 53 years of age, Chad, Guinea-Bissau, Afghanistan. Okay, I'm going to rip through this. These are countries with a lot of men, number of males per 100 females. These are United Arab Emirates, Qatar, Oman, Bahrain, Saudi Arabia. I think they may have used selective abortion because they have more men. For 100 women, you have 274 men.
That's a problem.
And then you have, it was a problem in China too. And then femininity ratios tend to be these Eastern European countries. But we're going to have to learn how to get along, and I'm going to flip over to a different section. This is just showing you how much this is our footprint. So Americans are the largest consumers. One American consumes like 20 Indians, 30 Pakistanis, 250 Ethiopians. This is a documentary, you can get it on video from National Geographic, and it's how much do you, an average American, consume over a lifetime? 3,700 diapers, 13,000 pints of milk, 2.5 tons of beef, 1.7 tons of pork. And meat is the big culprit. Meat requires, cows require 100 grams of vegetable protein to produce 15 grams of edible animal proteins, 30% of the Earth's usable surface is covered by pasture land for animals, 4% is used directly to feed humans, and you're seeing here that this is if we were to eat soya rather than meat, clearance of natural vegetation required to supply us with the same amount of protein would decline by 94%. Producing protein from chickens requires 3 times as much land as protein from soybeans. Pork needs 9 times as much, and beef is 32 times as much. So if you did have a concern about our footprint, probably reducing red meat would probably be the better way to go. But we're also going to look at different technologies. And so what you see, we need better contraception. There was a long-acting reversible contraception. It was extremely popular in Colorado. It helped impoverished women really reduce their rates and plan their first children when they were ready to be parents. Okay. Vasectomies. We need to drink shit water. This is recycled water, and it's from shit, and it's just filtered, and yeah. California needs to do that because they're in a drought. This is scuba rice. We need to embrace the green revolution. So this is the International Rice Research Institute. And this rice can stay 2 weeks in flooded terrain, and then it will go into a dormant cycle, and then it will end up, it seems like these scientists really get their hands dirty and are in the field. This is perhaps a solution, I don't know. This is vertical farming or aquaponics in places like Chicago, where you have this empty warehouses, industrial infrastructure here. And once someone from the plant came here, this is what happens is the fish shit in the water, and that's nitrogen, and that gets dumped on the plants, which have these LED lights. Smart grid. We need to have a smarter grid, so you use electricity more intelligently. The smart grid is where it's a two-way communication, where the grid talks to your plant to... it's a network that carries electricity from the plants to consumers, and it means a two-way digital communication so that your house can talk, if you'll let me say that, to the grid, and the grid can talk to your house. And it's big in Denmark. Wave technology, we're going to have to embrace some perhaps synthetic meat, which is being developed at Google. So we're going to have to develop and continue developing these technologies to accommodate a growing population, which eventually is going to stabilize and shrink. But at this stage of the game, we don't continue having kids when we have subsistence. At this point, our birth rates have gone down to meet the death rates, and we don't have unabated population growth. I was worried about going over, too. I was worried about going over.
All right. Now, I'm just going to put the microphone back here, okay? Because, now, are you on a hold? Go ahead. I don't need a mic, actually.
All right.
But I don't need a mic because people can hear me without it. Yeah. Now, let's get on with the question and answer.
Does anyone have a question?
Yes.
First of all, let me explain how things work, okay? I'll call on people, but of course, Corina is going to answer the questions. Now, if you have a question, raise your hand. I see some hands going up already. I just want to remind everybody that all questions must end with a question mark. Now, Tim, you had your hand up first, so go ahead.
Corina, did you see a correlation between the development of electric power and population reduction?
After World War II, we went through the baby boom. So World War II was done, and then we had a population explosion that really continued. So you have this large demographic of people who were born between 1946 to 1964 after World War. Yeah, so, and then after that, and then there's my generation, Generation X, which was kind of unwanted, or, you know, that was when people were on the pill, and yeah, so, no, I believe no.
Okay. All right. All right, sir, you had a question.
Thanks for calling me sir. I don't usually hear that. If I could get away with two questions. One is, do you accept Malthus's premise of the population outstripping the resources of agriculture to accommodate the increase in population? And the second one is, your blurb uses the term neo-Malthusian, and my question is, what's the difference between an Malthusian and a neo-Malthusian, and if I could say something that doesn't end in a question mark, maybe during a dinner presentation you should use the phrase consumption of diapers.
Okay, so Malthus was very descriptive of everything prior to the Industrial Revolution, and the rules changed after the Industrial Revolution. I'm currently now, and I found this just this week, but there is a economist at the University of California, Davis, and his name is Gregory Clark. Thank you. And Gregory Clark, his argument is that Malthus does a fine job, and he has a series of videos on YouTube, which you're certainly welcome to look at, Gregory Clark. And he talks and has it entitled The Malthusian Trap. And his feeling is that the biggest event, it was the Industrial Revolution, and then prior, that's where you actually, technology grew at such a rate where we can make gains faster than we can have, faster than our population growth. Your other question was? Neo-Malthusians are really concerned about, this is Paul Ehrlich, and he wrote The Population Bomb, and part of it is also part of the anti-immigration movement, Numbers USA. There was a book I read by Philip Cafaro called How Many is Too Many, and this isn't so much that you're just going to flat out run out of food and starve to death, but you're going to have natural catastrophes, such as, even if you do, okay, so we have a global warming that's like carbon dioxide, plants like carbon dioxide, but that seems to be more than offset by catastrophes that happen. Now, there was the Arab Spring, and that was when Russia had, I believe they were going through a massive drought, and then they put an embargo on their grains, and that really tightened the price of food in the Arab world. Which
so the deal is bringing developments, post-Malthusian developments into the debate?
Yes, this is really the book that is almost the Bible here. And Paul Ehrlich has since spoken, it's environmental degradation. For example, water. Okay, so you're destroying the water supply, or you're going to have to do desalination, but desalination doesn't come at a cost either. So.
All right, does anybody else have a question? Yes,
Yanibus. Yeah, I'd like to ask, you know, our famous mayor, he has a brother who's a brilliant medical scientist, Zeke Emanuel, is that his name?
Ezekiel.
Okay. He has written, and I don't know how, if this is a widespread support for this, he says that Americans should die at 75. In other words, some of us here should not be here.
He has an interesting point in that there are cases of people who have stage 4 cancer who are in their late 80s, and they're covered by Medicaid, and they go into hospitals, and they get every single diagnostic, state-of-the-art. They run up thousands of dollars in medical bills for taxpayers to pay. Older people are of value, and they're valued members of society, but when you're dealing with people with end stage, that really should, some people should get hospice care and not, I think that the baby boomer generation is going to redefine what palliative care and end of life process is. They've always wanted to be in control, and they're going to want to be not only in control of their lives, but be in control of their deaths as well.
Okay, who else has a, sir, did you have a question?
Somebody should have covered global warming. In California, you have...
Excuse me, sir, this is a time for questions, not for speeches.
California is absolutely going through a drought, and that was part of my presentation, but my presentation is so long, and I actually had pared it down. But what you do clearly see here is... we do have a tremendous footprint, and this is a water footprint on humanity. And you can see that China is a country with the largest water footprint, but that's just total water footprint, not water footprint per capita. In terms of water footprint, in terms of total footprint, we are the largest, we in the United States are the biggest perpetrators. Here we have the primary consumption of coal in 2012.
We're number one.
Yeah, and then with electricity, we're close to China, but remember that China has over four times the amount of people that we do. And the United States consumes the most petroleum. And so I really think it's kind of odd now that you're buying gas at around $2 a gallon. I thought I was going to be buying it at $5 a gallon, and I was going to accept that and not protest that. And I can't believe the price of petroleum right now. And now they've even talked in the car industry, oh, well, maybe we'll have a return to SUVs. Guess you haven't learned anything, you know. But we are the largest. Here you can see the growth in consumption of electricity. Now others, this is by tow, and a tow is, you can't see it, but a tow is a unit of energy defined as the amount of energy released by burning one ton of crude oil. And so we're using them. Yeah, so now this other is things like wind and solar. Okay.
What does that stand for, the MTOW?
Is a megatow. I think it's a 1 million tow.
All right.
And a tow is a ton of oil equivalent, which is the unit of energy defined as the amount of energy released by burning one ton of crude oil.
All right. Phil.
It was hard to jam all this into one talk. Yes.
Their lives kept around one of them. Do we have something like compulsory sex going on?
Nobody here is required to have sex.
Well, why not just keep the thing in your pants?
Oh, you mean sex education, Bill?
No.
Oh.
The people who do want population shrinkage are not interested in having an end to sex. What they want people to do is be able to, they want to enable people to have sex for pleasure without procreation. And so that's what's so important is you have to realize that sex can be for pleasure, not procreation. And I'm so thrilled that Pope Francis made his remark, what I'd like him to then start embracing technology. You're the Pope. You're the Pope. If you don't want people to have 8 kids, come on. Let's embrace orthotricycline. Let's allow for tubal ligation, for vasectomies, for condoms. So let's stop the spread of HIV. Come on, Frankie. I think Frankie's halfway there.
All right, Charlie.
Yeah, I didn't see anything green in which your data in which the population of one country affects the population or the living conditions in another. I mean, if there's a lot of Chinese making stuff for us Americans, that improves my quality of life, right?
It was really hard for me to jam all this data, and I'm not surprised that I went over time that I was trying to fit all this. This is a large topic.
I mean, the more Chinese there are, the better it is for us, right?
First off, I think that with all the automation, I think that it's hard to really have a strong labor movement when you have so much structural unemployment, which is another reason why I would actually like to see the population shrink a bit. I've seen so many jobs that no longer exist just through the use of kiosks when you go to the airport. I remember when you went to the airport and you waited in line to get checked in. Now you use automated check-in on your own, just cashiers and whatever. We do affect, and this is a net water import. Again, it was hard to fit everything into this presentation, but this is showing how we swap water. The United States gives or exports water. A large part of the water footprint is bottled water, and we're exporting water to Mexico, to China, to Japan. Actually, seems more Japan in a big way, and Korea. It seems like Japan needs a lot of water import. And then at the same time, we're also importing water from Canada, which we export to as well. But a lot of this water footprint is bottled water. And there has been now.
All right. Dennis, did you have a question?
I had a follow-up.
Wait, we got to, Charlie, we got to move along. Let Dennis have a turn.
I didn't answer my question either.
What was your question? I'm sorry.
Isn't it beneficial for my quality of life for there to be tremendous growth in Chinese population?
Yes.
And the other follow-up is this natural if population decreases that the hourly rate of pay will increase or not?
No, because jobs, even the jobs are, even if the number of workers decrease, jobs are being so automated so quickly between Google and Amazon. What if you don't have taxi cabs and you now have self-driving cars? How many jobs can that get rid of? I've seen jobs disappear. I've experienced it personally, obsolete jobs. People used to work as secretaries. Do you know anyone who introduces his or herself as a secretary anymore?
No, they're administrative assistants now.
Well,
no,
yeah,
you have
but
to do your own
executive assistants.
There's been so many offshoring. Now, there's a country, and it's real cheap labor. First off, they want to immigrate. What's going on in Europe right now, okay? What's going on in people from countries where they outproduce and they make too many people than they can handle? The excess number of people want to move. There's a number of them that are willing to risk their lives, risk their families' lives, and pay us and move to a more habitable place. Right. So it's not like you're born in a country and you're going to live there the rest of your life. People migrate, people move, and we're now at an age right now where there's massive migration, but I wish we actually had a tighter labor force. I wish we did. We see in the United States that if you are in a good job and you're paid well, then what we need to do is initiate a H-1B program so we can get more foreigners to come in and drive the wages down.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, Dennis.
Okay.
Corina, great presentation.
Thank you.
Would you comment on the current attempts by the Republican right-wingers in Congress to defund Planned Parenthood?
Terrible. And what happens is that this abortion has always been this red herring that you can always bring in the middle of a debate, and we're talking, abortion, ha, there, and it's always been something that has been thrown out, and I think that Planned Parenthood should split up. I think that since abortion is such an issue, I think that there should be a new organization called Contraception There. We don't provide abortions, we only provide contraception. That's it. Now, here I can show you, do you really not like a welfare state? If you're really against, I don't know if we really are against a welfare state. Over the past 6 years, Colorado has conducted one of the largest experiments with long-acting birth control. If teenagers and poor women were offered free intrauterine devices and implants that prevent pregnancy for years, state officials asked, would those women choose them? They did, in a big way. And the results were startling. The birth rate among teenagers across the state plunged by 40% from 2009 to 2013, while the rate of abortions fell by 42%. What did I just say? I just said the rate of abortions fell by 42%. This is something that fiscal conservatives and anti-abortionists can be very much behind. People do have sex, it's part of our nature. Paul Ehrlich talked about this in his book. So rather than trying to stop people from having sex, just enable them to have sex for pleasure without procreating. According to the Colorado Department of Public Health and the Environment, there was a similar decline in births for another group particularly vulnerable to unplanned pregnancies, unmarried women under the age of 25 who have not finished high school. But we have a sex ed that is risible. Now you have the hormonal IUD, the copper IUD, and the birth control implant. We're not talking about abortion. Can you use my tax dollars to give out free IUDs? Hell yeah, I don't have a problem with that. And this experiment in Colorado needs to be replicated, needs to be reproduced. It could be reproduced in Chicago, absolutely.
All right, sir, did you have a question?
Yeah, one thing you didn't mention is, where does war fit into this whole population thing?
I really don't think it does. Now, the Civil War, what happened is that people died, and many people may have been shot by a gunshot wound and survived, but then obtained an infection. We've been in a war 10 years in Afghanistan and Iraq, and I think we've lost less than 10,000 people. We're doing more surgical strikes. There was a massive tsunami in Indonesia, and 100,000 people died. It doesn't take long for you to regenerate 100,000. Surprise! You know, it doesn't take long. So war used to be a massive. The Civil War, 600,000 people died. Americans died in the Civil War, but 600,000 people haven't died in Iraq or in. There's people now also who would have easily have died in war, but because of the brilliant surgeons, they're able to live. They may have severe brain damage, post-traumatic stress disorder, but it's really not the big way. It's not an efficient way of narrowing down the population. The more violent populations, the hunter-gatherer societies, used actually war and violence as a means actually of reducing.
Right. Go on. But I have a follow-up question to his question, if I may.
Yes.
Since we're talking about the connection between war and overpopulation. Do you think that the wars that we've been experiencing, since the 20th century began, have any connection to the population explosion? In other words, I don't mean that does war reduce population,
over the long run. It obviously does not. But as you just demonstrated, but what I'm saying, do you think that overpopulation?
There was a pretty strong argument by Jared Diamond that the Rwandan conflict, that very bloody Rwandan conflict, well, it came out as an ethnic fight. But he really saw that as a fight over resources, a fight over land in a very overpopulated country. I also mentioned the Live Aid or Band-Aid effort. That really was kind of an ethnic cleansing effort in Ethiopia, which has a very high birth rate in a land that isn't super irritable.
So you're saying that the famine that happened in Ethiopia that caused the whole Live Aid movement, that famine was a result of
ethnic, it was more than just it was pure natural disaster.
There was a result of ethnic cleansing by the Ethiopian government. Is that what you're saying?
I'm not going to say that authoritatively, but that is my perception. But you all have rebuttals and can correct me, which is good.
All right.
But now you know there is the Arab Spring, and there's countries. And now in Egypt, Hosni Mubarak was in charge of. He was a dictator in Egypt. He was actually for smaller families. He wanted to create tax incentives for women to have less kids, and that was one of the reasons why he was unpopular. I'll have as many kids as Allah will give me. But you have, when you're having, I'm 22 years old, I'm in this country, I don't have a job, I have a degree in engineering, and I'm really angry, and I don't imagine a future. I think that does lead to violence. I think that leads to violence in Honduras, El Salvador, Guatemala, and I think that leads to violence in Chicago, in Chicago's South Side. I don't see a future for myself. I don't ever see myself being able to own my own home and this or that, so.
Okay. All right, we got a question from Dave. You had your hand up before. Go ahead.
Are you for or against California building desalination plants so they can start tapping the Pacific Ocean for water?
I don't know where it ends. You drain the aquifers, and then the farmers continue to grow hungry and lucrative crops. Almonds are hungry crops. And it's like you haven't learned a single thing. I think that California is an area of the country that is overpopulated and should depopulate. I also know that a lot of people now are retiring, and they want to retire in Utah, Colorado, Arizona, New Mexico. Those are watertight areas. People are leaving this Great Lakes region and moving to areas that are watertight. I have personally met people who've lived in they've lived in Atlanta, Georgia, and they've gone through water restrictions, and they've seen some very ugly results of that. I think California is overpopulated. I think that the farmers in the Inland Empire continue to grow thirsty crops. And maybe we need to grow, and I don't know how realistic this is, but possibly grow crops, the interior, you know, in greenhouses. There is a massive greenhouse movement, and urban farming is very popular, but it's not a viable solution to really fill grocery stores. But the local war movement isn't going to work, but it's nice to grow your own tomatoes, right. Yeah.
Doug, you had a question.
There are so many questions. This was a brilliant talk, by the way.
Oh, thank you. And it was overstuffed, but yes.
The more the merrier, come back soon. Would you go out on a limb and say we should get rid of the deduction for dependents? possibly even take away some deductions from people that have excessive number of, quote, dependents. Accepting adoption.
Well, I thought that there was a major reform by the Clinton-Gore campaign. It was Clinton and Gore that Henry Cisneros, Hope 5, under he was the head of HUD, Housing Urban Development, and he came to Chicago and ripped down what were the Robert Taylor homes, Washington Gardens, Cabrini Green. Yeah. And I also know the Pruitt-Igoe homes in St. Louis were torn down, and at that time that was just no good. I thought that they had you can have as many kids as you want, but the government's only going to pay for two of them. And that's what I thought.
Well, I don't remember that, really.
Okay, I thought that there was a welfare reform. I would limit it definitely at two. There has been a crackdown. There was a point where men just impregnated women and left, and there's been a strong crackdown. Oh, you don't want to pay for your kid. Well, that's nice, but I said you're the father, and we're going to take money out of your paycheck. So it may behoove you to get a vasectomy rather than impregnating every woman you take home. So there has been more of a crackdown, but I would limit it definitely to two children.
Ellen.
Don't you see there being that there's a problem? I don't think there's any restriction on how many children you can have if you're on welfare, but I mean, there's plenty of states now, like Texas, is the biggest one, that, you know, there's extremely limited access to abortions. And so you can't really limit the number of children people have if you refuse to give them access to abortions. So that's an inherent problem. I think also, like, South Dakota has very, very few abortion clinics.
Excuse me, Ellen, do you have a question?
Yeah, I'd say, don't you see that there's a problem between...
Some of the women who most need access to contraceptive care, it's the hardest to get to. Come on, guys, get behind this this experiment in Colorado. We want to replicate Colorado's effort against teen pregnancies. We want to be able to allow women to control their reproductive lives. There was something called a temporary vasectomy. I don't know if it ever did go to market, but this was a vasectomy that was reversible. Both men and women should be able to have control over their reproductive lives and continue to enjoy sex.
Right. We're not going to have time. It's almost 8 o'clock. We're not going to have time for a second round of questions. So I'm afraid, and I'm sorry, Yanibus and Charlie, but Bob Matter's question is going to have to be the last one. Go ahead, Bob.
Karina, do you think this 14th Amendment we have that gives everybody that's born in the United States citizenship, do you think that's a wrong incentive to have? Would you support whoever the next president is going for an amendment or something to correct that 14th amendment? Say that if you're born here, you're not a citizen.
Only the qualified.
This is a very tricky question, and one that this only isn't the first time that I've ever been confronted. Should you have citizenship? Does that encourage? I think that a lot of people from South America come here for jobs, in that when the jobs dry up, a lot of them will return home. I think that we face bad consequences because of the violence that was wrought on Honduras and El Salvador and Guatemala, and so these places are unlivable, and we're now suffering for our sins that we did in the 80s. LA North, just terribly horrible, violent societies, and the war on drugs, which has really devastated Mexico, and luckily we made strides and is beginning to end. But legalized drugs destroy the drug cartels. Someone strong needs to take control of these countries that are unlivable, that are violent.
Should we amend the Constitution, yes or no?
No.
Let her answer. Yes. Let Corina answer the question.
Let her purchase citizenship.
If other countries also don't have birth citizenship, we shouldn't either, but I believe that is currently the international standard. So I believe if I went to France and had a child, my child would have a right to French citizenship. I'm not sure. So,
all right,
please rebut me on that.
All right, folks, that's going to have to be it for the questions.
I'll sell mine.
So let's have a big hand for our speaker tonight. All right. Now, as for the rebuttals, how many people?
people want to speak. Everybody that wants to speak, raise your hand.
20 of us.
Okay. All right. Okay. Keep your hands up. Keep your hands up, y'all. One, two, three. I'm counting Tim as a four.
Yeah.
Five, six, seven, eight, nine. Keep your hands up, y'all. 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, and 15. No. Just a second. 15. It's gonna have to be 3 minutes each.
That's fine.
Tim, did you get that? 3 minutes each.
3 minutes each. I'm getting a timing device ready now.
What? Tim, talk to me.
We're gonna go 3 minutes. I'm getting a timing set up now.
No, it says I'm not connected. Let me try to connect.
So, how's the peanut gallery doing?
Love it, man. 3 minutes.
Okay.
That is
the exciting
part.
I
can count
too.
Wait,
Mio. All right. There, I got a dollar. Okay.
The more Asians there are, the more stuff we get.
Keep it down.
Right?
Keep it down.
I'm getting everything.
You just talk like you're a professor.
We look at the world population, we find a few things that are outstanding. One is, if you go to Western Europe, like in Germany, Italy, France, and places like that, you'll find that the population growth is mostly due to immigration from the Arab countries, from other countries. There was war in other countries where the industrialization is just not there. And actually, if you look at the indigenous population in these Western European countries, you find that the population is actually going down. Like in Italy, there's not enough workers, so they have to import a lot of workers. And then if we go to other countries like India, third world countries, we find that the population growth mostly has to do with agriculture. That is, the people need a lot of offsprings in order to work on the farms, in order to go out and make a living, even to beg in the streets, in order to bring home money. So for the most part, I think that's the reason for it.
All right.
And if we look at the growth of crops, now, I'm not saying right now, but at one time, California could grow enough crops to fill the whole population, almost the whole population of the earth. So we had enough crops. But now, of course, we have global warming, and the situation has changed. And we have all these wars in the Middle East, and you get all these people leaving and trying to make a decent living, and they'll take their lives in their hands in order to go to a place like Germany or even Greece, which is in pretty bad shape, or Yugoslavia or something like that. And she pointed out certain countries where the population isn't growing. And you might say the average income has gone down quite a bit. Like if you take the East European countries, like Czechoslovakia, Latvia, Hungary, so forth and so on. And that's because under the socialist system, people are actually living better than they are now.
30 seconds, Ed.
But they don't want to talk about that. You don't hear a word from the Western press. And these have more or less become dictatorships And that's one of the reasons why the living standard has gone down in those countries.
Time,
all
Sid.
Right, brother Sid.
All right. We have a timer system. You can see it from the podium and you can see it here. 3 minutes.
I like this presentation. The PowerPoint slides show exhaustive research into seminal documentation on Malthus. The slides effectively demonstrate Malthus' pessimistic dynamic structuralism relative to global resource limits. This presentation is a good counterpoint to positive dynamic structuralism, as we find, if we are familiar with it, with Hegel, Teilhard de Chardin, Alfred North Whitehead, and Steven Pinker. Thank you.
Reset, Tim.
We got it.
There was a famous saying, I think during the Clinton years, where they said, it's the economy, stupid. Well, when you're talking about birth control, 99% of all sex happens not to make a baby, but to have contact between people. They've done all kinds of studies on animals, young kids, babies in orphanages. The ones that are handled and have contact thrive, and the ones that don't have much contact, they don't grow up as well. A lot of animals will die if they don't have contact with their mothers. There's a book published in 1983. Let me have a show of hands here real quick. Who here knows a woman that has children or grandchildren? Because there's only three females here tonight. So a lot of people know somebody that has kids or grandkids. Well, if you wanted to get rid of the problem of unwanted babies, you can teach what came out in a book in 1983 called ESO. Everybody familiar with that book? It's blacked out. In America, the wages of sin is pregnancy and death. That's all you can teach in high school. We have all kinds of stuff talking about contraceptive, all rubbers, vasectomies. Well, if you teach that there's two kinds of sex, like some European countries teach, there's pregnancy sex and non-pregnancy sex. In America, if people were satisfied with their sex lives, half the economy would collapse overnight. We use models, men and women both, to sell a whole range of stuff. The American economy is based on using sexual images. Buy this product and you'll be sexually fulfilled. Well, the book we're talking about is called ESO. It was written for couples. Extended Sexual Orgasm, written by a Phelps and Donna Brower, a husband and wife team. They taught simply that there's a form, it's non-pregnancy sex. Nobody wants to admit having, pardon the expression, first-hand knowledge of it. But that's what they're talking about. You and your partner, basically you take a survey. You find out what feels good when you touch it. You touch it till you feel good. You touch it till you feel better. And you touch it till you pass out. When you wake up, you're completely satisfied and you didn't produce a baby. If that philosophy were taught in America to young people from the time they become thinking about sex, young people could have long, happy sex lives without ever risking pregnancy or getting any kind of sexually transmitted disease. So as long as I've been coming here, nobody has ever talked about that subject, the concept of having truly safe sex.
Okay. So, all right. Good luck. All right.
What having sex without enjoyment?
When we rise, but can I speak for myself?
I've got too much.
First time since I'm coming here, I have to agree with Andy. it's a good news, right? I hope it is a good beginning. I think this young lady spoke. It's one of the most best presentation I have seen here.
Oh,
you know, she was very knowledgeable. She had details. She had good answers. She had mastery of her subject. And I think we should have more speakers like that. The population problem is more severe where I come from. And the one of the things helping more, even when I talk with people from Pakistan or in Arabian countries, people who are educated, they think differently. They want to have lesser kids. They want to have their time with their kids and make them better and raise them better. But people who don't have education, and it's a problem. So we can do a lot better by educating the whole world. You know, giving them the basics, giving them the more knowledge. And once they hook to knowledge, they'll do better. Second thing is that religious people who are very fundamentalist, they are a big problem, either Hindus or Christians or Jews or Islamic. They are a huge problem in a not only educating the people, but making a social changes in a society. I mean, a Republican Party, their conservative wing is an obstacle to our economic progress and our society progress. And we have a problem with the Democratic Party that they are not finding effective solution, effective organization. They believe more about talking than doing. See, Barack Obama had a great opportunity to bring America together, but he did not. Black and white come together. He did not. He did not know when he started it, and he never tried. Okay. Whatever I think technology ultimately will solve the problem, because technology will change the lifestyle of people, their sexual lifestyle, it will change. The concept of family and parents are changing. So they are no longer family. Okay. Only responsibility we should structure our family based on children's welfare. They're not on a husband and wife. You don't have to be husband and wife to make a baby. But you make a baby, you take care of. Thank you.
All right.
This guy got
turn your phone off.
All right. Well, I'm interested in this subject. It's basically the carrying capacity of the world, which I checked on the internets. And I guess we can handle it, this current lifestyle, 10 to 14 billion people on the planet.
Yeah, we're getting the upper limit.
Yeah, so we're getting close there. One good thing is you look at the charts and the population is increasing at a decreasing rate. So I think we're gonna just make it in time so there won't be too many people on the planet. But more importantly, this water here, we're talking about renewable and not renewable resources. This glass of water will be here a billion years from now. Water is renewable. Water will always be here. This water will be here longer than the ages. So, but there are things that are unrenewable, like oil and coal, and not too many other things. So I think the most important thing is if we're going to be burning coal and oil for decades and hundreds of years, and it's not renewable, we have to do something about it. So I think renewable resources have to be the emphasis going forward, and not the unrenewable ones. So enjoy your glass of water. It'll be here forever. Thank you.
Well, don't worry about it.
Okay. I'm gonna just fix the microphone here, guys. Just a second.
Millions of gallons of water.
Okay, I don't know how to handle this.
I'll get it, John.
Now, just a second, I'll figure it out. Just. Okay. Like this, maybe? Okay, but you do it. Yeah, you do it.
You're Tim's the expert at the microphone.
Yeah.
All right, Dennis, go ahead.
My name's Dennis Nelson. If you check the speaking schedule, it just so happens that I am to give a Earth Day, Earth Month presentation about the infamous bet between Stanford University biologist Dr. Paul R. Ehrlich and University of Maryland Business Administration Professor Julia L. Simon on April 23rd. This will focus upon the contrasting worldviews of the neo-Malthusians, represented by Ehrlich, and the cornucopians, represented by Simon. So I'm inviting everybody to come. Being a neo-Malthusian myself, please stay tuned because we're going to continue this discussion at that time. After I graduated from college, a relative of mine, Coy Howe, a lay minister, asked me to teach the senior high Sunday school class at our church, Broadway United Methodist Church in Council Bluffs, Iowa. One of the things that I did was put together a special three-part ecology unit. I included a guest newspaper column by Dr. Garrett Hardin, professor of human ecology at the University of California at Santa Barbara, and another neo-Malthusian. Dr. Hardin asked, was Thomas Malthus right about overpopulation on Earth? His answer was what I would have given, yes, because we have to live within limits. Well, on October 14, 1992, Julian Simon had a debate with Dr. Norman Myers, an environmental consultant and still another neo-Malthusian at Columbia University School of International and Public Affairs in New York. This event is chronicled in the book, Scarcity or Abundance? A Debate on the Environment, W.W. Norton and Company, 1994. Even though the debate happened almost 24 years ago, there's still information of merit which pertains to this evening's topic. Now, Corina covered what Thomas Malthus said about food production and population growth. And Corina also mentioned Norman Borlaug. He has been called the father of the Green Revolution. And that's why Norman Borlaug received his Nobel Prize. And well, according to Dr. Norman Myers in this debate, the Green Revolution produced enough grain to keep ahead of population growth between 1950 and 1984. However, this has come with the ecological costs of environmental degradation. Soil erosion, soil depletion, and salinization of irrigation systems. Well, right now, what we need are humane policies to reduce and stabilize our population growth at a reasonable level. And we also need truly sustainable organic agricultural programs to adequately feed malnourished and undernourished people. So my defense of Thomas Malthus rests, at least for now. And I had other material, but I don't have time to do it. So we'll see everybody here on April 23rd, and we'll get into it in more detail. Thanks.
Yeah. Weren't you just up here?
No, that was different.
Track.
Well, I'm Harris Yanabas. My revolutionary name is Harris of Chicago. What I want to bring up is two sides of the coin. Our learned and very well-informed and very knowledgeable speaker spoke very much on very vital issues. And I'd like to expand on that by bringing up two kinds of issues. One of them is opposing the birth of people before they are born. And if I may ask for a sense of the Senate here, I think that's the way you use it in the Senate. How many people here, if you raise your hands, would support once and for all to clarify the issue that abortion should be a constitutional right of every woman?
Yeah.
Okay, the majority probably, or 60%, but in any event, I'm not so much concerned about the women because they're adults. You know who I'm concerned about? I'm concerned about the unhappy babies, because me, I didn't have a happy childhood. Thank God I had good parents and I survived. But the thing is, no child deserves to be born as an unwanted baby. Just a few months ago, a girl threw out from the 8th floor a little baby that was born to her. The streets are full of homeless people. They were unwanted babies. Fathers left they just had knocked up the mother and never showed up again, or they were alcoholics, or they were drug addicts or things. So why should we perpetuate human suffering? I'm concerned about the babies. I say no baby should be born as an unwanted child. And then I go to the other side of the coin, and that is killing. I'm a child of war. You know, I was born in Greece, and I survived the German Nazi Holocaust in Greece. And I was lucky I did not become an orphan at the age of six, because my dad, having been in America for many years and a World War I veteran, he spoke English, and when the German officer was taking him to the death march about 10 miles away to be executed with a bunch of other Greek patriots, he felt sorry for my dad, let him come back. And so I was spared the tragedy of orphanhood at the tender age of six, thanks to a compassionate German officer. So that is one thing. And the other thing is the doctors. You know, this is the most homicidal profession. There is no other profession except the professional killers in the armed forces. And the doctors, they kill so many people in this country. You know, they alleged...
Yeah, no, but...
this what they
3 minutes. Time.
You know,
time.
And we'll never find out.
Come next week. Next week, I'm finished.
We'll never know.
All right. Thanks, Corina, for a great speech, a great topic. And like Raj, I'm embarrassed to admit I have to sort of agree with Andy for a change, and I commend Andy for what we would call in Indiana thinking outside the box. Chuck was worrying about population growth and its effect on wages and things like that. Well, I got bad news for you, Charlie. There's this new book out by this economist, Robert Gordon. I think it's called The Rise and Fall of Growth, or The Rise and Fall of Productivity, or something like that. Brand new book. But essentially, the century that went from 1870 to 1970 saw all the big inventions, you know, indoor plumbing, refrigeration, automobiles, you know, all this stuff caused this huge growth in, you know, economic activity, and it enabled everybody to have these great standards of living. But you know what? All those kind of you know, great big inventions are pretty much over, and the new inventions don't require this kind of intense labor input. So there's going to be quite a bit less demand needed in the future. So this is why he's called his book, you know, The End of Growth. I think it's called The End of Growth, or Rise and Fall of Growth. It's just not, the new jobs and stuff are not going to be like that. You know, that period from 1870 to 1970, you know, we saw huge buildings of infrastructure, you know, like the Golden Gate Bridge, you know, stuff like that. But that's pretty much over. I mentioned the 14th Amendment thing. I just read Ann Coulter's book, Adios America. I strongly suggest you all read it. And I think that this birthright citizenship does provide a wrong incentive. It's encouraging, you know, every, you know, third world peasant to come over here and drop an anchor baby in America, that then we will have to end up, you know, educating and paying for, you know, welfare and healthcare and Social Security and all this down the line. So I think we need to look at that. Having immigrants come in, if they're scientists, engineers, doctors, you know, that kind of thing, that's a different story. But we're having this, you know, third world invasion of basically peasants, of unskilled labor, and that is what we don't need. These people do not have the means to support all the children they're having.
All right, I'm a
going to be a little early. Let's thank our speaker again. Very good, whoever she is. I'll be very quick. I won't take up a lot of time here. The basic premise of the theory, apparently, that overpopulation would maybe have a negative or detrimental effect. However, as I asked in the question, due to the significant population in China, I'm able to have all sorts of material goods at a very economical price. Therefore, the population in one country, an overpopulation, benefits my country. So there seems to be a difference here. When you compare it also to the fact, now here's another one you have to think about, is that if there's more Americans buying Chinese products, that would benefit the Chinese. So therefore, overpopulation in both countries is beneficial. I didn't prove it. Now, the other thing that was thrown at me, even among my colleagues back there, was that, oh, there's something called technology. And now I'm hearing from my friend Bob here that not only is there another, if you wish, variable called technology, there's a something called the new technology. Well, this is getting a little more complicated here. And guess what happens when your suppositions or assertions get complex? You know what I begin to think? That maybe they don't have any validity. Guess what? And then, yes, there is a technology is a very adequate one. The major thing in here is sustenance. But if anything, the technology in terms of agribusiness has made it possible, probably we could survive several planets and made this whole discussion kind of mute. Because thus agribusiness and with genetically modified crops is going to render this entire discussion kind of meaningless. But yeah, I got some things to think about here. But and last of all, though, as I said, if anybody wants, the other thing is about the Mexicans coming over here. I believe it's a misconception, and I'm sorry. I think the other thing is about the population in here. If what really comes down to it is that the productivity of the, if you wish, the illegal immigrant. He's paid for himself about 100 times.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, Charlie.
So there. And he wants to buy my citizenship. I'll sell it to anybody.
GMO
Charlie. $10.
Buy that for a dollar.
GMO Charlie.
Yeah. Let's go have some babies.
When I was a senior in high school, kid gets up in class and says, some human sociologist wants to sterilize all but a small percentage of the men. And control the population that way. And I said that was a bum steer. But I think there's one factor that hasn't been examined tonight. I think the idea of these babies are unwanted. Well, maybe I think we have something called compulsory sex, maybe not by force, but everybody's supposed to just do it. Whether it's going to have consequences or not.
Tuesdays.
Hey, Steve. So, I think maybe we ought to learn different ways of being in bed together without actually inseminating the woman.
All right.
Hey, Steve. One fool at a time.
Hello, hi. Okay, thank you, Corina, for an excellent talk. Okay, I just want to make a couple of comments. First of all, I was reading a book by the author of the man who wrote this book called Countdown. I can't remember whether it was the Countdown book. And he's talking about demographics and population. And one of the things I thought was really interesting, especially given that it's an election year, is that he was talking about for the past several decades, that when the Republicans get in power and become president, there's a massive decrease in family planning worldwide. You know, I mean, the United States, spending for family planning. And when the Democrats get in office, there's a massive increase in family planning that the United States gives. And he's saying that, you know, basically, when the Republicans are cutting this family planning to third world countries and other places, first of all, there's a massive increase in the number of abortions. There's a massive increase in the number of maternal deaths because, you know, women are having children in countries where, you know, they don't have good obstetric care. I was reading several years ago, I'm not sure whether I assume the statistics have improved some, but in Afghanistan, and it was the worst in the world, you know, 10% of the women were dying in childbirth. So, you know, there's a massive increase in abortions and maternal death, lots of poverty because women have more children, increase in child mortality. So this is a really serious issue to consider when you vote. And then another, you know, I think Paul Ehrlich, who wrote The Population Bomb, I didn't read the book, but I think this issue of resources is a really critical one. Whether we can, you know, we can support, you know, we're degrading the environment. Take a class in environmental science and you'll read all about it. And it's not going to be fixed so easily. And with this massive population increase, even though it is not accelerating as quickly, it's still a major problem, whether we're going to have the resources to
30 seconds.
Okay. And then the other thing is, I just want you to know that as of like 10 years ago in Illinois, there was a law that all the HMOs had to give all this money for fertility treatments for women in Illinois, and I happen to know a woman who specifically switched into an HMO just so she could have all this fertility treatment. It was a lot. Now maybe things have changed. So.
All right, thank you.
Is there less water on Earth?
Yes, again, a terrific talk by Corina, very well researched, a tremendous amount of information there. Not enough time. We should have more about this. We will, of course, when Dennis talks April 23rd. Very courageous talk, too, especially bringing up the subject of shrinkage with so many men in the audience. That took a lot of guts. So. I thought that was a joke. Nobody laughed. I remember back The Population Bomb, reading that book. It was the big news back in the 70s. And, of course, there was a Club of Rome around circa 1980, I believe. She didn't mention that in the talk, but the dire predictions then were that, you know, within a short time, I think about a decade, shit was really going to hit the fan. And, of course, the wild card was that increases in production enabled, even though the population did not start coming down as early as Paul Ehrlich had hoped, the production managed to overstep the predictions of the worst Malthusians at that time. So the jury being out, yet we have all of these things like vertical farming, which she brought up, and the possibilities of technology striding ahead. Yet there is there seems to be definite physical limitations, even though every molecules of water can be separated and reconstituted. Pretty much the amount of water that's on the planet now is going to be the same a century or probably a million years from now. Well, maybe not that much, at least thousands of years from now. But as far as potassium and nitrogen being able to be fixated in the soil, fertilizers, the problem that we might run out of fertilizers is a serious issue. 1 minute to go. Another wild card is artificial intelligence. I wrote a play back in 1989, was produced in 1991 here in the city, involving an artificial intelligence program, which acquired enough knowledge. It was called Socrates, so it had a bias towards
wisdom and humanistic qualities. So that was a positive viewpoint of what technology could do. This computer program recognized environmental dangers and the danger of global warming at that time and tried to help humanity. So we might hopefully get some assistance with expert systems and a greater use of artificial intelligence if it's used in the proper way. And thank you very much for the talk, Corina. All right.
Okay. Done.
Anybody else?
At me.
What?
Well, after you're done, I'll go.
Okay. Wait a second. Why don't you, Tim, why don't you go next, and then I'll go after you.
Okay.
What?
Yeah, there's normally moderator goes second to last.
Do you want me to run the camera?
No, I think we're all set. Corina's talk can basically be summarized in the following way. As populations, education levels rise, as median income rises, the CAA calculates it at about $10,000, children tend to be less born and the fertility rate goes down. And this is a very easy reason to explain. The cost of raising a kid gets much higher in a developed country than it is in an undeveloped country. When a child is looked at as a source of labor and a means to support, there's going to be a lot of them produced. But when you get into a developed country like the United States, kids are very expensive. It costs about $250,000 to get them through education and college and everything else. And then they come back after they get out of college. The funny thing is that what is required is a lot more resources to do this. But a lot of the environmentalist movement talks about curbing growth, curbing other things. This is why, and if you also look at the basic development of electric power and its propagation through countries, that tends to produce development. I've seen these arguments many, many a times at my at the Thorium Energy Alliance conferences myself. And the need for, you know, just basic electric power. I'm not going to get into where the nuclear or anything else, but when you have really power to the people, things change. Education levels go up, mortality rates go down, population goes down because it's a little more expensive to raise a kid in today's society. That's all. Thank you.
Two things we can generally count on at the college complex is the two rules being broken and Tim talking about thorium.
I didn't even mention it. I didn't mention it.
Timer. Okay. All right. Yeah. Would you mind resetting that? Oh, there you go. Okay. All right. This has been a really interesting presentation. It's a lot of information we had here, talking about, and this is a very, of course, it's a very pressing issue. I mean, you know, because it has implications across a lot of other issues. The whole question of the population explosion. That being said, and I studied biology somewhat in college and learned about Malthus and the population problems. And Malthus's predictions actually didn't come true, at least with regard to Great Britain, because he was talking about his own country. I mean, one thing he didn't take into account was that industrialization would lead to a rising, higher standard of living, and also the greater ability of the country to support a higher population than an agrarian society could support. What actually happened, that Britain's population didn't go to 128 million. It stabilized at around, 60, 70 million now? And they have a much higher standard of living now than for the average person than they had in Malthus's time, and they do it with far more people than existed in England in Malthus's time. The time that Thomas Malthus lived, England and most other countries, and almost I think every other country in Europe, most of the people lived in abject poverty, and today, most of the people throughout Western Europe live quite comfortably, and here in North America too. So, and we do it with a very large population, but that is because, as Tim was saying,
because of technological improvements in various ways that have made it possible for us to support a much higher population than we had. And it is, in fact, thanks to the Industrial Revolution. Now, now that being said, it is a real issue, because the more people we have, look, each one of us is putting a stress on the environment because of our consumption of the Earth's resources. And the more people we have, the more stress is put on the environment. How many people can the planet hold? So it is still a serious, Malthus didn't get it 100% right, but it is a serious issue. One thing that hasn't been brought up tonight that I would like to bring up, though, is the connection between population control and women's rights. And I'm not just talking about the right to abortion and birth control, which was raised, but they found that in countries where women get an education on a par with that of men, the birth rate goes down. If women are thought of in the society as just being there to make babies, women will get married off at age 14 or whatever, and have, you know, 9 or 10 kids. But in a, let me just make my point, Tim. But in a society where women get a college education, and first of all, they delay having children until they're more settled, right. And second, they've got other things to do besides having kids. So I think if we want to bring the population down, support women's rights.
All right, Corina, you're on.
And now it's Corina's turn to have the final word.
No, the problem is not your children, women, girls.
Yeah. All right.
Bimbo girls.
Charlie.
Well, first I want to address Andy's, this is for Andy, this is from the population bomb. We need a federal law requiring sex education in school. Sex education that includes discussion of the need for regulating birth rate and of teaching techniques of birth control. Such education begin at the earliest age recommended by those with professional competence in the area. Certainly before junior high school. By sex education, I don't mean courses focusing on hygiene or presenting a simple-minded birds and bees approach to human sexuality. The reproductive functions of sex must be shown as just one of the functions and one that must be carefully regulated in relation to the needs of individual and society. Much emphasis is placed on sex as an interpersonal relationship, as an important and extremely pleasurable aspect of being human, as mankind's major and most enduring recreation, and as a fountainhead of his humor, as a phenomenon that affects every aspect of his being. Contrary to popular mythology, sex is not one of man's least animal functions. First of all, many animals and plants get along without sex whatsoever. They reproduce asexually. It is clear from biological research that sex is not primarily a mechanism of reproduction. It is a mechanism that promotes variability. In many organisms that do have sexual processes, these processes occur at a stage in the life cycle that is not the stage at which reproduction occurs. And of course, no other animal has all the vast cultural ramifications of sex that have developed in human society. In short, sex as we know it is a particularly human activity. It has many complex functions other than the production of offspring. It is now imperative that we restrict reproductive function of sex while producing a minimum disruption in the others. I think that Tim had a very, very, very cogent rebuttal. Yes, so the demographic transition model, it shows that eventually, you know, first the death rates go down, but the birth rates remain traditional. But then the birth rates do go down, and that goes down when the cost of having kids goes up. When kids no longer, we had summer vacations so kids could get off and work on the farms, okay? And moving from agricultural to a knowledge-based economy, and there's other aspects of this as well. I think the Catholic Church has less control over people, has less influence in America. I grew up, went to St. Paul's Catholic Church, and all of us had families of two or three kids, on rare occasions, sometimes four children, and that usually involved twins. So I think the Catholic Church has less influence on people's lives.
What else? Well, I would like to play a video, but I don't know if I can. I don't know if it would work.
My computer's connected now. Yours is off.
All right. So, the Gapminder video was Dr. Hans Rosling. He's a Swedish physician. And so the question is, if you save lives, is that just going to lead to overpopulation? And the answer is no, because what happens is that people now have too many children to overcompensate for the fact that one of their children isn't going to make it. So when you can greatly lower infant mortality, you can increase the chances that a child is going to make it to adulthood. People will, in addition to women having careers, women working, and having electricity, people do have less kids. The last thing I want to do is for Ellen, just a sec. All right, so there's some organizations like Pathfinder International, the Guttmacher Institute, and these are, there are organizations that are concerned about sexual health worldwide and allowing availability of contraception and ability to make informed decisions. So we should explore these organizations such as Pathfinder, Guttmacher, Planned Parenthood International, United Nations Population Fund.
Close us out, Bob. All right. And this concludes tonight's College of Complexes episode. Let's remember.